Hey there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory. In this Star Hopping Extra, we're going to start a new feature topic, something many of you have been asking about, basic astrophotography, and the three ways you can start to capture the cosmos with your camera. More about all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 22 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm absolutely elated to be your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. So this is going to be the first episode to cover a brand new topic area on star hopping, astrophotography, capturing the night sky with your camera. I've received some requests from a few of you out there to start some basic discussions about the process, procedures, and equipment needed to capture beautiful astronomical images with your camera. One of the main challenges with visual astronomy, especially with beginners, is that deep sky objects generally appear very different in the eyepiece of the telescope as they do in the pictures they've seen that initially attracted them to the hobby. In the telescope, most objects appear ghostly white and without color. That's because the sensory cells in our eyes are just not excited enough by the dim levels of light coming from these objects through the eyepiece. Not to say that the photons are dull and boring, it's just that they're dim. But everything changes when you use a camera and start taking time exposures, setting your camera to open its shutter for much longer than usual as compared to when you take terrestrial photos or normal snapshots. These pale deep sky objects then appear in vivid colors like reds, pinks, greens, and blues, and are sublime to behold. When you capture your first successful astrophoto and see that color, it is absolutely amazing, and you'll definitely be hooked. As you may know, when shooting a regular daytime picture, the camera shutter opens for a very short period of time, say 1/2000th of a second. When that shutter is open, it exposes the CCD sensor in the digital camera to light. This is known as an exposure. When you do astrophotography, in order to collect enough light to form a sufficient digital image in the camera, exposure times are measured in minutes and sometimes hours. The biggest challenge to this concept is that while the shutter is open and the camera is collecting light from an object in the sky, the Earth continues to turn, and the celestial target moves in the sky on a line from east to west. Unless you have some way to counteract that motion, you'll end up with trailed or blurred images, and clearly, or unclearly in this case, that's just not what you want. So your options are to counteract that motion or to avoid that motion altogether. So how do we do it? Here are the three basic methods for taking an astrophoto, going from the most simple to the most complex. They are time exposures of the night sky using a fixed tripod, which lets you create star trails or time-lapse movies. 2, mounting your camera on a mount or telescope that is tracking the stars, otherwise known as piggybacking, which lets you take images of large deep sky objects like this one. 3, mounting your camera on the focus of a telescope, thereby using the telescope as a long telephoto lens. This allows you to capture smaller objects and get close-up images of deep sky objects like this one. Now, astrophotography is an extremely complex topic, and there are many variations of processes and procedures for each of these ones that I presented. So I definitely have plenty of content to cover for this new feature topic. If I tried to cover all three of these, even at a high level, in one episode, we'd be here for a couple hours. So we'll cover just method one in this episode and get the rest over time. So before we get too far, let's talk a little bit about the camera. I came up in astrophotography using SLR film cameras. SLR stands for single lens reflex, meaning there's a single detachable lens on the camera and the optical view from the lens was reflected by an angled mirror inside the camera. The light then bounced to a prism that reflected the view from the lens to the viewfinder that you could look through with your eye. In today's world, we have DSLRs, digital single lens reflex cameras. This is primarily what I know about, so that's what I'm going to be presenting in this series. It's amazing what some people are doing with cameras and smartphones nowadays, and also GoPros, and there are tons of tutorials out there for those. So we'll be talking about using Canon DSLRs for astrophotography, which is a very common selection of many astrophotographers of all experience levels. There are other more advanced options like CCD cameras that I can discuss in future episodes. In these episodes, I'll assume you generally know the features and functions of your camera. I'll explain important terms and settings that are needed to accomplish a specific type of astrophoto, but again, for learning basic DSLR camera usage, there are zillions of tutorials around the internet. So with all that said, onward and upward. Let's talk about time exposures using a fixed tripod. There are lots of cool opportunities for great images here. One of the easiest is a polar star trail, like this one I took of Comet Yakutake at the pole. They can be quite spectacular. This is an instance where you actually want to show the star motion, and it's the whole point of the image. In the northern hemisphere, all the stars appear to rotate around the north star Polaris in the constellation of Ursa Minor. It's important to find a location where you have a dark sky to the north. Light pollution will definitely ruin this kind of shot. So for this type of image, you'll need the following equipment, and I'll provide links to some of them in the episode notes. 1. A DSLR camera with the exposure time set for 30 seconds. Make sure your battery is fully charged and have a spare one as well, as long shutter durations tend to suck up batteries in DSLRs. 2. A fairly wide-angle lens, 50 millimeter or less. The wider the better, really, for this kind of shot. 3. A sturdy tripod. 4. An electronic cable release, an intervalometer, or a computer that sets up a repeating set of time shots. These kind of shots are more interesting if you have something on the ground in the shot, a line of trees, or a building, or some other interesting foreground object. Place your camera on the tripod and frame up the shot. Make sure you have the ground and the sky well above Polaris in the frame. Open up the aperture on your lens the whole way to pick up the most stars. Then on your camera, set the ISO setting to 1600. The higher you set the sensitivity, the noisier the images will be, but 1600 is a nice middle ground that'll let you get lots of stars, but a reasonably low noise level. Take a series of timed exposures and try to minimize the time between shots. Keep at this for as long as you can. A couple hours of exposure gives you a nice long star trail. At a 30-second exposure, you're looking at 120 frames per hour. That's why it's nice to have an intervalometer or a computer to automate this whole procedure. But it can be done by hand if you bring coffee. So after you're done with this sequence, you'll have many successive frames that you're going to need to combine by stacking the images on your computer. There are lots of pieces of software that do this. I use NEBULOSITY by Craig Stark and can do a demo on it sometime in the future here. When you stack all the images, you'll have a complete arc of stars around Polaris. A second type of image sequence is another tripod shot, but pointed at another area of sky, like the Milky Way or generally any nice dark area of sky with an interesting starscape. The procedure is similar. Take many exposures of 30 seconds or less, depending on light pollution. Then you can take that sequence and assemble them into a movie using software. On the Mac, I use Time Lapse Assembler, which is free. This results in a neat time lapse that shows the stars slowly moving across the sky. There are some units out there that control the whole imaging process, and between each image, it slightly rotates the camera. So in the end, there's a slow pan that really enhances the time lapse. I have a unit by Alpine Labs called Radian that will automate a series like this and perform panning functions too, as you see in this movie. I can do a review of this product in a later episode. It's really great. The speed of the motion in the movie is dictated by the frames per second that you select when you assemble it. 15 frames per second is about the minimum that you can use to get smooth motion. 24 or 30 frames per second will give better results. So if you take an hour of 30-second shots, you end up with 120 frames to work with. Then at 30 frames per second, your time-lapse movie will only be 4 seconds long. At 15 frames per second, it'll be 8 seconds long. So again, the more frames you take, the longer your movie can last. But if you don't want to make a movie and only want to capture a single frame, then you can set your camera exposure to bulb, use an electronic cable release, as I mentioned earlier, and then experiment with exposure length to get the most stars, the least light pollution, and the least star trailing. The wider the lens, the longer your exposures can be before the stars begin to trail. This is a way I mentioned at the start of this episode to avoid the star motion. You can also play with your ISO settings on the camera to increase sensitivity and then use shorter exposures to avoid the trailing. Just remember, the higher the ISO, the noisier the images. The name of the game here is experimentation. With patience, you can get some great shots like this one taken in the field at KPO. So let's review. We've entered a fantastically exciting and complex area of astronomy in our study of basic astrophotography. We started out discussing the three basic forms of astrophotography, which are time exposures using a fixed tripod, piggybacking your camera on a mount or telescope, and mounting your camera on the focus of a telescope. Then we dove into fixed tripod astrophotography and talked about creating star trails around the pole, and then explained how to create cool time-lapse movies showing stars moving across the sky over time. Lastly, we talked about capturing single-image wide star fields by experimenting with exposure length and ISO settings. Over the next months, I'll inject one or two episodes between the normal star hopping episodes. It'll work out well, because we do occasionally have to wait for more interesting targets to rise up in the east between the star hopping episodes themselves. So that does it for this week's show. You can find the show notes on our website at kpobservatory.org/SH022, where you can comment and leave any questions that you might have. Thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week in our episode of Star Hopping.
I'm Cassie, and I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these video astronomy tutorials every week on Thursday, and in their podcast format on Fridays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them on the internet. The reason we create these videos and podcasts is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests for potential targets in the night sky that you would like to see us discuss, just let us know down in the comments section below, or on our website blog. Don't miss our free field notes for this episode, basically the script of the show, with all the images and star charts we use for our star hopping activities. You can get them for free at kpobservatory.org/fieldnotes. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button, click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. Also, as I just mentioned, please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astronomical digital images, and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places in cyberspace, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts, and help us make even more great astronomy tutorials, just like this one. So bye for now, and thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.